Well, as we start chapter 11, as if it hasn't been exciting enough, we really get into some fascinating verses, especially from the point of view of world events today. Now, to be very clear, and some of you have heard me say this, I am not a big fan of what I call newspaper prophecy, which I define as every time there's a hiccup in the Middle East, someone's pointing to a verse from Ezekiel or something to say, this is the fulfillment. A lot of those end up being empty. And yet, at the same time, it is wise to look at the course of our world and the events of our world. And as we see what the scriptures predict, we can see definitely a lining up and a connection, and it should excite us. We should recognize, wow, I don't know when the Lord's coming back, but boy, it could be soon, because it's not that hard to imagine things coming together as the Bible says they must. And so as we get into chapter 11 now, and we are looking at just the first two verses, let's read them. John writes, then I was given a reed like a measuring rod, saying, rise and measure the temple of God, the altar, and those who worship there, but leave out the court which is outside the temple, and do not measure it, for it has been given to the Gentiles, and they will tread the holy city underfoot for 42 months. The first thing to remember as we look at these verses is John is writing Revelation at the end of the first century, approximately the year 95 AD. That means the temple in Jerusalem, the temple that we know from the Gospels, the book of Acts that is so relevant there, had already been destroyed. The Roman Empire destroyed the temple in Jerusalem in 70 AD. There is no temple standing. And yet John is given command to measure the temple. In the context of building, the reed was a common way to measure linear length for the ancient world. For one thing, they could exist rather long, and if you wanted to break it to get a certain amount of distance, you could, and they were light. And so it made for a very easy measuring instrument. You know, they didn't have the retractable tape measure that you hit the button and the thing comes back. And so that's what's going on here. Take this measuring rod, this reed, and measure the temple of God, which, well, it's already been destroyed. But the interesting thing is, both the Apostle Paul and the Lord Jesus Christ himself made prophetic statements about things that would happen in the temple that you cannot find fulfilled before 70 AD and its destruction. Well, that means, since Paul is certainly not a false prophet and the Lord Jesus Christ is never wrong on anything, that means there has to be a third temple to come for those prophetic things to come to pass. And so John is told to measure the temple. And notice, lest someone say, well, isn't the church the temple of God today? Yes, that is a reference that we read. There is no temple standing. There hasn't been for quite some time. Again, almost 2,000 years. But the temple of God, we're told, is also a reference to the believers in Jesus Christ. Why would that reference be made? Because the temple was the special dwelling place of God. Now, we know God is omnipresent. He fills the universe. But God dwelt in the temple there in Israel, he said, in a very special way. And God dwells in the believer in Jesus Christ as well today, as the Holy Spirit indwells the child of God the moment we are born again and we are sealed to that day of redemption by the Holy Spirit. But this is clearly not any relationship to that idea of the temple, because notice, there's also reference to the altar and people worshiping there. So a future temple with sacrifices on the altar and worshipers all taking place. And clearly in the city of Jerusalem, as we have the reference holy city there in verse 2. Notice also it says, leave out the court outside the temple. That's just given to the Gentiles. Let them trot around on it. Now, the interesting thing about the temple, this word here speaks to the what we might call the sanctuary, the holy place and the holy of holies, the place where the priests went in. Of course, the holy of holies is where the high priest only went in once a year. If you look at the law of Moses, you look when Moses was given instructions by God for what was the tabernacle, the sanctuary, you find that the dimensions are quite modest. Specifically, this area was only 45 feet long and 15 feet wide. That's not very big. Now, of course, the altar was outside of the sanctuary, but all in all, this would not be a huge amount of territory. Now, if you are familiar at all with Israel today, you're familiar with the Wailing Wall. You see the people that go up to that wall and pray. That's actually a retaining wall from the temple that was around in Jesus' day that was destroyed. And that's all that's left standing. So it's a very holy, sacred spot. And not just Jews, but people from all nations can go there and say a prayer, write a prayer, put it in a piece of paper in the cracks of the wall. And it's a very reverent place. In fact, as you leave it, you walk backwards. The idea is you don't turn your back on, you know, where God supposedly is in a special way. But that's all they have. If you go to the Temple Mount above where the retaining wall is, that big flat area, you notice, and of course you see it in all the pictures, that big golden dome, which is actually a Muslim mosque, known as the Dome of the Rock. And it's pretty much right there in the center of that area. But if you are up there, and I've been up there, and you can look at pictures certainly online, you find out that there is a pretty large open space up there where they could easily rebuild a temple along the lines of what was given in Moses' day. Now, there's another word for temple that's used in the Bible sometimes, and it's a much broader term, and it involves all the courts and the precincts and so forth. In Jesus' day, you had the sanctuary, as I described. You had the area where the priest would minister, and then you had an area where Jewish men could go and worship who weren't priests, but they were Jewish men, and then a little further back, the Jewish women, and then a little further back from that, Gentiles could come. And it was in that court of the Gentiles where all that bartering and trading and buying and selling was taking place, causing all that noise, and Jesus put a stop to it when he said, my house is a house of prayer for all nations, because that's the place that all nations, the Gentiles, could go to pray, and that's why he put a stop to that. But you see, when we're talking about here in Revelation, we're not talking about this huge bit of property. We could have a very modest temple built, and then we wouldn't have to do a thing with the Dome of the Rock Mosque. Because people say, well, you're going to have to get rid of the mosque. No, you don't. In fact, what do we read right here? Leave that outside. Don't worry about that. We're going to give that over to the Gentiles. And you can imagine some sort of a wall or some sort of a partition separating the two. And the Jews and Muslims wouldn't even have to probably pass each other. They could come up at different entrance ways. It could happen, couldn't it? Now, it would be quite a political achievement, though, for it to happen, wouldn't it? You see, Jerusalem is no doubt the most controversial city on earth. When Israel was reestablished as a nation back in 1948, they did not get granted to them by the world the city of Jerusalem. In 1967, the Six-Day War, as it's called, was when the Israeli army took the Temple Mount there in Jerusalem. And it was a great time of celebration that lasted a very brief moment of time because the politicians quickly stepped in and said, oh, we don't want to have too much controversy here. And so they immediately gave back control of the Temple Mount. And the Muslims actually control the Temple Mount today in the city of Jerusalem. If you are a Jew, or for that matter, if you are a Christian, you can go up onto the Temple Mount. You can go visit it, but only as a tourist. You are not allowed to pray, and they have monitors watching you and will stop you, and it'll cause a ruckus if you do. You cannot pray. In fact, husbands and wives can't even, you know, give each other a kiss or hold hands or any sort of just normal marital affections. They control it. The Jewish people do not. Only the Muslims can worship on the Temple Mount. Of course, they have their mosque. They actually have two mosques up there. Now, as I said, it would be quite a political feat for there to be a Jewish temple rebuilt there. Not only that, a Jewish temple is rather meaningless if there's not going to be the animal sacrifices. So imagine that in our political climate today. You're going to have a religion that's going to offer these little lambs, they're going to be slitting throats and shedding blood all over the place. And yet, that's what's going to come to pass. And for this, I would like us to go to Daniel chapter 9. Turn to Daniel chapter 9, if you would. Daniel chapter 9 is a foundational prophecy in that chapter for understanding the end times as God has declared. I've taught, of course, through the book of Daniel, including chapter 9, but I've referenced Daniel chapter 9 many other times. For today's purposes, I'm going to have to summarize quickly a few things and focus in really on one main point here. But to summarize Daniel chapter 9, Daniel is given a prophecy that 490 years are determined upon Jerusalem and the Jewish people. And from a certain starting point, which also is declared, there will be 483 years from that starting point until the Messiah arrives. And exactly as God's word predicted, the Messiah arrived 483 years after that starting point, and it is the day that we know as Palm Sunday, the day that Jesus allowed himself to be worshipped as a king. After those other times of saying, my hour is not yet come, my hour is not yet come, then that one day he allowed the people to cry out, Hosanna, blessed is he who comes in the name of the Lord, and he rode in on the donkey, fulfilling that prophecy. And that's why he wept, because he said that if you'd only known this, the day that belongs to you, Jerusalem. But then he predicted the judgment that would come on Jerusalem, because of course they were rejecting him. Now many were receiving him, but the religious leaders and the heads of the nation would have him crucified a few days later. As the psalmist said, this is the day the Lord has made. Now, we like to apply that on some random Thursday when it's not too hot and the sun's shining. Oh, yeah, this is the day of the Lord. No, that's a prophecy. That was speaking of that day. The day that was promised all the way back in the Garden of Eden to Adam and Eve. The day that God would send a Savior. Fulfilled. Just as Daniel 9 said. To the very day. And Daniel 9 went on to say, but the Messiah is going to be killed. He's going to be cut off. He's going to be put to death. We know he was crucified. 483 years, but that leaves seven more years, doesn't it? And there's nothing that takes place afterwards to fit the 7 years that are described by Daniel, and that's what we're going to look at today. So if you're in Daniel chapter 9, look at verse 27. Verse 27 says, then he, now who is the he? It's not Jesus. The he is a reference back to the prior verse of someone who's known as the prince who is to come. So a new leader that's going to come on the scene is the he. He will confirm a covenant. In our language today, we would probably say a treaty. With many for, and I know it says 1 week in most translations, but again, that's a week of years. We have a week of days, 7 days, but the Bible also talks about a week of years, and that's how this prophecy is set up. So in other words, he'll confirm a treaty with many for 7 years. The period in Revelation that we are studying that takes up the bulk of the book, the tribulation period, is 7 years in length. In fact, if you noticed, and again, I want you to stay in Daniel, but you remember how it said the Gentiles will trot on the city for 42 months? Well, what's 42 months? It's exactly half of 7 years, isn't it? It's 3.5 years. So something big happens in the halfway point of 7 years. Well, let's keep reading Daniel. In the middle of the week, in the middle of 7 years, that sounds like 3.5 years. He, this prince who will come, will bring an end to the sacrifice and the offering. And on the wing of abomination shall be one who makes desolate, even till the consummation which is determined is poured out on the desolate. Jesus referenced this as an abomination. He's going to desecrate the rebuilt temple. And Paul elaborates by saying that he's going to go in there and he's going to sit in the temple as God and demand to be worshiped as God. And it's also going to be the starting point, if you will, of a tremendous Jewish persecution such as they've never experienced. Now, let's go back to Revelation. You see, the Jewish people, and again, I'm speaking of those like the Orthodox, religious Jewish people, because there are people who have Jewish blood, they might be atheists, but we're talking about those of religious faith. They know what God's Word says. I mean, they may not look to the New Testament like we do in the church, but in the Old Testament, it's pretty clear that animal sacrifices are essential. Because without the shedding of blood, there is no remission of sins. Now, they know that they don't have a temple, and the rabbis over the years have explained to Jewish worshipers that, hey, because we don't have a temple, God knows that. He understands that we should try to live a life of good works and so forth. But there is that recognition. We need to have a high priest once more. We need to have a temple. We need to have the sacrifices. Yom Kippur isn't supposed to just be simply a day of reflection and fasting and so forth, but it's supposed to be the ultimate sacrifice as the high priest goes into the Holy of Holies and makes the sacrifice for the sins of the whole nation. They know this. And they would love to have a temple. Of course, they know the political obstacles to that. The thing is, there is a division of thought, because many of these Orthodox Jewish individuals, they don't think it's up to man to build a temple. But you know what they do believe? They believe when the Messiah comes, He'll build the temple. We'll be able to know the Messiah when our temple is rebuilt. Well, doesn't that fit in with what we just read in Daniel chapter 9? A treaty that this guy, not the Messiah, not Jesus Christ, but the false Messiah, what we call the Antichrist, who is a political person, as we're going to see, not a religious person, first and foremost. He's a political guy. He's got a religious sidekick. We'll see him later too. This guy is going to be some sort of a political genius, and he's going to work a peace between the Jews and the Muslims that all the world will get along with, and the temple will be rebuilt, and he'll make sure that it all takes place, and that things will be going on, and then halfway through those 7 years, he's going to show his true colors. He's going to stop the Jewish sacrifices and so forth. He's going to demand to be worshipped as God. And we'll see there's some other things taking place as well we'll look at starting next week. And this is why I said at the beginning, you can look at the news, you can look at current events, and you can see how this could all come together and relatively quickly, couldn't it? If all it takes is a political agreement, as incredible as that political agreement may seem to us today, like who's going to work that out? Well, we have no idea who's waiting in the wings someday. But we also know this. I said that the desire for the temple is strong among so many. They've actually been producing the various implements and priestly robes and so forth that would be necessary, that would be a part of temple worship. If we only have a temple, we're going to be good to go, up and running really quickly. And with our construction abilities these days, I imagine they could build that temple in a day, literally. And I think the motivation would be there probably to work around the clock, right? Bring in some floodlights and just go for it. And they could build that building very quickly. And they'd have everything ready to go. And we can see that that's something that could be taking place literally at any moment. We see how quickly political events change around the world. We're very hopefully optimistic today at what we're seeing taking place in Korea. I don't know what's going to happen, but we certainly are seeing things that we haven't seen in 60 years. Most of us probably remember when the Berlin Wall fell down. It's just, how did that happen? You know, all of a sudden. And this is yet another event. But you see, one thing I would like also to point out in all of this, and notice even in the contrast, you know, we're going to have this temple, which is obviously Jewish. Leave that over to the Gentiles. We have that Jew-Gentile distinction once more being emphasized in the book of Revelation. Where's the church? We're not listed here. We're not shown here. It's yet another point of emphasis on what I know to many people seems strange, and some people don't believe in it, but what we know is the rapture of the church, where God removes the church before this final seven-year period of time. As he said in Daniel, 490 years are determined upon the Jews, upon Jerusalem. 483 are already in the rearview mirror, but there's 7 years left to go. And we see a seven-year period of time in the book of Revelation, and throughout that seven-year period of time, you never see the church mentioned. And yet, what we do see is the emphasis on the Jews, on Jerusalem, in contrast to the Gentiles, the unbelievers. And so God is going to remove his people. Now, that's just one point. And as I said, there are those who take issue with that. Now, over the years, I've run into many. I consider them friends. They're certainly believers in Jesus Christ. But in talking to them, and they can be very dismissive of the rapture. They think we're a bunch of nuts. And I think that that's because Satan has used a couple guys in history who are nuts, quite frankly, you know, and the TV cameras get on them because they're actually predicting, you know, the day of the rapture. And anyone who knows their Bible knows that you cannot predict the day. God's very clear on that. So the moment some guy comes up and makes a big to-do and CNN shows up and all these guys, you know that that's just the enemy trying to make us look foolish. But at the same time, in talking to other believers in Jesus Christ who don't hold to the rapture view, I have one question I always ask him. I say, when was that last seven-year period of time in Daniel fulfilled? What took place? How do we read that anywhere in history? Tell me. And I can talk to five guys. I'll get eight interpretations. There's no consistency, no clue. And usually it's like, well, I don't know. It doesn't matter. I don't know. It doesn't matter. I think when God's given us his word, it matters. And I think that we are commanded to study, to show ourselves approved. And I can understand, how Christians from 400, 500, 1,000 years ago never dreamed of the idea of a Jewish nation once more being formed, and certainly not a new temple being built and all those kind of things. But we're not living 1,000 years ago, are we? We're living today. And again, going back to my original warning, this is not newspaper prophecy. This is just having our eyes open to the reality of taking God's word as literally as we can. Why not? He wants to communicate to us. So what does that mean to us? Is this just a bunch of head knowledge? No, because every generation, and certainly we should be at the front of the line, has lived as the scriptures commanded with the expectancy that the Lord could return at any moment. See, we don't need to have all this stuff going on in Israel for the Lord to take his church. But the fact that all this stuff is ready to go is just sitting here like a big play and it's off on the side curtain ready to come out. That fact spurs us all the more. And whenever Jesus was talking about his return, and he did speak of his return, often in parables, but sometimes straight on, but it was always about, therefore be about the Lord's business. Be living for the Lord. Be serious about your walk with Jesus. Live for him. Because that time is coming. Like a thief in the night. Unexpected. Not knowing. And we have the good news to share with others. Because let's not forget what we've seen in the last few chapters before we get to this interesting discussion in chapter 11. The death, the famine, the pestilence, the war, the things that are coming to this earth as a part of God's hand of judgment are incredible and to be avoided at all costs. And it is so easy because the Lord's made it all possible. No one escapes the judgment to come by being good. No. It's because we've been declared righteous through faith in Jesus Christ. And God will not judge the righteous with the wicked. It is that simple in so many ways. If you don't know the Lord Jesus today, now is the time of salvation. Call on the name of the Lord. And frankly, isn't it true that even if this stuff wasn't all going to come to pass for another 100, 200 years, you and I sure don't got no 200 years, do we? God will be calling us one day, even if it's not as the whole church, calling us by name. Individually. It's appointed unto a person wants to die, after that the judgment. Now's the time of salvation. Now's the time to get right with the Lord. And to share the good news with someone who's lost. We'll continue on in chapter 11 next week, looking at the ministry of these two witnesses in Jerusalem. Let's pray. Lord, thank you again for your word and the time we've had once more to study the things to come. And we know we see through a glass darkly, but it does seem like things are becoming more and more in focus as to how it's all going to wrap up. And that's because you've given us your word and we happen to be living in the times in which we live. So we pray, Lord, that we would live our lives in such a way to show the belief we have in these things, that we might appear before you at any moment. And so help us to live in a way that brings glory to you. Forsaking temptation, forsaking sin, repenting, confessing, forgiving, loving, serving. May that be our life, Lord, we pray. We ask in Jesus' name. Amen.